After a great night of line dancing and partying at the Bar 10 Ranch, it was time for us to start our third day of the JK experience by hitting the trail again and making our way back to civilization. Our first stop of the day was over at the historic Mount Trumbull Schoolhouse. Built by homesteaders back in 1918, it served its community as a school, church, dance hall, and town meeting site for well over 40 years. Burned down by vandals back in 2000, a replica was built by descendants of these early settlers, and today remains open to the public to enjoy. On the move again, we pushed our way north up Main Street Canyon and then turned east to work our way over the Virgin Mountains and towards the town of Mesquite, Nevada. Back on pavement for the first time in over 250 miles, we topped off our dry tanks, lightened our load at a hotel, and then got right back on the road again. Our next destination, the Logandale Trails. Working our way up a trail that some refer to as the Matterhorn, there are two obstacles that make this otherwise easy trail into a real challenge. The first of which was this, the entrance to the bowl. For thousands of years, the pink sedimentary rock in this wash resisted rushing water that would eventually carve it into a pair of tight and narrow turns. Today, it's an obstacle known as the S-turn, and it still did what it could to resist a series of JKs working their way through it.
Thank you.
before losing all our daylight, Mel decided to take a few of us on one more run, and that would be up a trail known as Bronco Falls. Situated within the dark red sandstone formations that dominate the area, this is what most people think of when talking about Logandale.
Nice having a Nitto semi. We have onboard compressors, welders, 110, 220. We got a mobile workshop anywhere we're at. So that 24-hour Walmart, we should be able to fix every car here.
From day one, Rescue One had been experiencing problems with overheating, and with all the wheeling we'd been doing in triple-digit heat, it had only gotten worse. If there was any hope of keeping it on the move with the rest of the group, something had to be done.
The V8 swap won't keep up with the radiator at all, not even on trails, on highway, on nothing. We're in the middle of Nevada trying to do some wheeling on-road, off-road. It's not handling at all. So we're trying to line it up, and then we're going to try to get more water capacity in there. We're going to pull out the welder, the tire machine, the spare tires, all the tools. That should line it up probably about 1,500 pounds right there by itself.
We're trying to put her on a diet.
Like a 30-gallon barrel, we just got a 5-gallon barrel, so now we got an extra 5 gallons of water running through the heater Corvette. It's gonna definitely help. So we'll get it going. They're gonna still bypass our morning run and catch us with us at lunchtime, but they're gonna test it out today. It should be about 102, 103 today. So this extra 5 gallons of water, hopefully, that helps out a lot.
Heading north out of Mesquite, Nevada, we started our fourth day of the JK experience with an epic trek across the Tule Desert and out to the town of Caliente, 160 miles away. We'll be right back.
It'll sound like maybe a broken ring and pinion, the housing broke. So we'll get it up here, assess the situation. If we can weld it, we'll weld it and keep going. If not, we'll drag them out.
I think it broke ring and pinion because he bent the rear end.
Yeah.
It was over those whoops, so I was, you know, hit those really hard.
Oh, you launched it?
Yeah.
How much air do you think you got?
We had it all four off, and then it was just whoop, and we thought, uh-oh.
1001.
It was still going. I thought, okay, no problem. This thing is tough.
How much clunk is it making?
Occasional clunk.
Go drive up behind me. We're going to put a strap on you.
In the town of Caliente, we rendezvoused with the Evo chase truck, got Dave's Jeep loaded up onto a trailer, and then got right back on the road again. Our second half of the day was going to be a road trip across the infamous Highway 375, better known as the Extraterrestrial Highway.
Is a supposedly secret area inside Nellis Air Force Base. Nellis Air Force Base takes up a huge area of Nevada, central Nevada, and we are on the east side of that, and then further east is the Utah-Nevada border. So we're going up Highway 93, now we're on the extraterrestrial highway, which is going to kind of go over the top of Nellis Air Force Base.
With almost 200 miles between gas stops, it's hard to imagine that anything exists along this barren stretch of highway, let alone a full-service saloon known as the Little A. Lee Inn. Located in the town of Rachel, Nevada, it's become a bucket list stop for sci-fi junkies, alien hunters, and conspiracy theorists alike. After a long journey to the west, we pulled into our home for the night at the Mizpah Hotel, which is located in Tonopah, Nevada. Built in 1907 and beautifully restored in 2011, the Mizpah once stood as the tallest building in the state and held that title until 1929. Whether it's true or not, some of the legends surrounding the Mizpah Hotel include Wyatt Earp having kept the saloon, Jack Dempsey being the bouncer for it, and Howard Hughes having been married there. Of course, today, the Mizpah's biggest celebrity is none other than a ghost known only as the Lady in Red.
It's haunted. It's a haunted hotel.
She was the lady of the night, and she was on the fifth floor. She was caught coming out of a room that she wasn't supposed to be coming out of. So the gentleman that did not like it, she got killed by him in the hallway. We do have a lot of stuff that happens on the fifth floor. I was actually working the night shift from 10 to 6 a.m.
Yeah.
These ladies were staying in it, and they got locked out of her room. We ended up having the manager go up there, because it's joining rooms to 505, and he tried getting in. We tried everything for 2 hours. All the lights were off. By the time we got in, all the lights were turned on, all the deadbolts were locked, and nobody was in the room. There were no windows open, no nothing.
That is cool, really?
Yeah.
Good morning. This is, I don't even know what day it is right now. It's Thursday morning. We had a great evening at the Mizpah Hotel over here in Tonopah. We're getting ready to head out. It's nice and cool right now. So we're going to do probably 250 miles a day. We got a couple stops planned, and we're going to end up in South Tahoe tonight.
About as soon as we hopped on the highway to head out of town, we were right back off again and starting our fifth day of the JK experience, running a good stretch of the 2013 Vegas to Reno race course.
This is what happens when you drive like an ape. So he totally lost control, ran off the trail, and then hit a huge rock about 60 miles per hour, and then got airborne, and then somehow we landed back on the trail and then up the other side. So now the Jeep's broke.
He had a power steering issue. He stopped, and then it wouldn't start again. We cycled a few times, I couldn't hear a fuel pump going. So we used a hammer to help persuade it a little bit, and it started working again.
In spite of all our efforts, it would appear that Rescue 1 was still having overheating issues, and enough so now that it was going into limp mode. Out in the middle of nowhere and with very few options available, Mel decided to strap it up to Evo 1 and tow it all the way to the nearest town, which was over 60 miles to the north. As luck would have it, we were able to track down a GM mechanic in the town of Hawthorne, Nevada, and with the tools he had at his disposal, this is what we found.
The temp sensor was pinned at 265, which would put it in a limpo mode and make it act like it's acting right now. Oh, we just found a water pump leaking.
So what's the plan now?
Trailer.
Completely out of options, it was time to load up Rescue 1 on a trailer and tow it the rest of the way to Tahoe. Although we all suspected as much, it wasn't until we pulled into the town of Gardnerville and was told to pick up some camping supplies that it became clear we would be wrapping up our JK experience with a trip across the Rubicon Trail.
You guys excited?
Yeah!
Right on.
And I didn't break anything.
Yeah. You just said that.
No,
that's okay. You know what? I've done it every day, so I can talk about the day that I did it.
I didn't say it.
Hitting the road at the crack of dawn, we started our sixth day of the JK experience, heading west across the Sierra Nevada mountains and on our way to the start of the Rubicon Trail.
This is the legendary Rubicon Trail, my favorite on the map. It's just gorgeous, like wheeling Yosemite, and I hope you all enjoy it. Let's communicate. We only got a couple more days left. Let's have a great time. This is God's country out here, so let's get going. There are several optional obstacles along the Rubicon Trail that'll put even the most capable rigs to the test, and one of the toughest ones is this, the Soup Bowl.
Yeah.
We're on a little sluice. A lot different since last year, but still challenging enough for the guys to have a good time and everybody smiles.
JKX experience, right? That was the man.
The old sluice is one of the last sections of the original Rubicon Trail that is just as challenging today as it has been for decades. In fact, due to the very real potential of doing some body damage, only a handful of us would ultimately decide to take it on. Back in the day, miners built sluice boxes to help them find and trap precious heavy metals. Here on the Rubicon, I think Mother Nature may have built the old sluice to do much of the same. Right about now, I think Dave is feeling pretty happy that he decided to leave his hardtop at home.
Right there like that. You're fine, you're fine. A little bit, that's good. You're fine. Perfectly fine. Hard driver now, hard driver. Start. Good. Whoa.
Talk about close calls.
You're so clear.
I didn't think there's a place that even looked like this that even existed. You know, you only see it in the videos and stuff. You're like, ah, man, that's just camera angles, you know, but. By far the best trail I've ever been on.
Nice.
By far.
Home at last. In spite of our large group and all the extra time we spent playing along the way, it was a pleasant surprise for us to make it all the way to Rubicon Springs, and with plenty of daylight left in the sky.
Got a little shrimp action, you know. I had to bring out the grill and do the good stuff. I mean, I don't want to share my secret ingredient, but it's parquet.
As Mel had said before, this is God's country. And without question, the hardest part of the Rubicon Trail is having to leave it. Cadillac Hill really is the last leg of the Rubicon Trail, that can still prove to be a real challenge. And just as we started to make our way up the first switchback, we heard a loud bang in the distance that didn't sound too good. Now, a loud bang like that could have come from just about anything, like maybe a large branch breaking off a tree or something. Or maybe not.
Working here through this rock, and I mean, it didn't seem like we had a lot of pressure on it, but all of a sudden, just snap, knew something wasn't right.
So what all broke?
Right now we can see the truss snapped completely off. It looks like the drive shaft just separated, so none of that broke.
Thank goodness,
so yeah, thank goodness. And I'm thinking a sway bar in there too might have broke, but
perfect.
We can deal with that. We'll get the truss weld on, hopefully we're ready to rock and roll.
With the help of two winches, a high lift jack, a welder, and some ratchet straps, we were able to make a trail fix that we thought might be good enough to get Dale off the trail. Fortunately, we were wrong.
Good day on the Rubicon, typical Cadillac Hill. Last day, we're gonna keep everything moving. We're gonna leave one Jeep here and come back tonight or tomorrow morning and come get it out.
Let's go, find a seat, let's go, man. Lock it up.
The original plan was to come back in the morning to recover Dale's Jeep, but once we got to the top of Cadillac Hill, Mel had a change of heart.
We're gonna go back down, try to recover your vehicle right now, because otherwise, tomorrow, there's no way of getting back down. There's so many people coming out.
After sending the bulk of our group back to South Lake Tahoe with Jim, Mel, Ned, and I turned around and headed back down the hill. Back at Dale's Jeep, it became clear that the second brake was a lot worse than the first. Thanks to the pinion yoke being jammed up against the gas tank, it would take three winches, two high lift jacks, and a ton more welding to get the axle straightened out and secured enough to give it another go.
Oh, there it goes, I heard it.
Yeah, it didn't go all the way.
Hey! Are we still connected with the pot?
Yes, still on the tree.
A little more? A little more?
Running in front-wheel drive only and strapped up to Evo 1 for support, it was time to head on home.
just glad we're moving again. That was just depressing. Seeing this thing, it was just pathetic.
While I think everyone would have been understanding, it's never an easy thing to leave a Jeep behind. Fortunately for us, we didn't have to, and with everyone back on pavement again, our final day of the JK experience would be one that we could all finish together as one. Ago, 40 people and 19 Jeep JK Wranglers from around the country set out on a journey across America's wild, wild west. Along the way, they would travel almost 1,000 miles, cross 4 states, and put their modern covered wagons to the test, and in a way that most could only have dreamed of. But then, this was the off-road evolution JK experience, and the adventures they take you on really are the stuff that dreams are made of. As always, keep the shiny side up, all four on the floor, and with any luck, we'll see you on the trail.
I'm gonna sing a song by Johnny Cash. So it's called I've Been Everywhere.
Yes!
Well, I was towing my bike along a dusty one of muck road, when along came a semi with a high canvas covered load. He said, if you're going to win a muck a mac with me, you can ride. And so I hopped up in his big jacked up Jeep and I settled down inside. The man asked me if I'd seen a road with so much dust and sand, and I said, listen, I've traveled every road in this here land. Well, I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. I cross the deserts bare, man. I breathe my air, man. I've had my chair, man.
Stop. Big Brock. Right there.
Okay, so I don't know all the details, but from what I understand, Ms. Bach.
He doesn't know that.
She didn't ask for
something. No, I can't help it. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. I cross the desert bare, man. Creek the mountain air, man. Travel about in my share, man. Well, I've been everywhere. I've been bartending, tossing, taking, raising, and washing, using, closing, testing, and handling,
look at your little babies.
My little baby.
Hey, get in my belly. Get, I want your baby. Get in my belly.
Rocky, what we have here is what makes you alcohol.
That's a mossy ball. The Irish, I didn't like him anyway.
I didn't have a bad day yesterday. He's gonna have a bad day. Like, look at that guy. He knows he's in chorus.
She's a city girl. She don't know about slide and turn. Rear end, right and left around turns.
Yeah, what did your wife say about me?
I told her that Eddie backed off from filming it. She said he was a pussy. He should have kept filming me.
That's going to go in the video.
Yeah? That's all right.
I've been everywhere, man. I cross the desert bare, man. Breathe the mountain air, man. Travel that in my share, man. I've been everywhere.